My Hollywood by Mona Simpson. Narrated by Bhama. 50-50.
Once, we sat with a small candle between us on the tablecloth, drinks for our hands. After the salad, he asked if I wanted children. I don't know. I fingered the glass votive. I'd like to, but I don't know if I can. That got his attention. His whole head stilled. My hands fluttered to reassure. No, it's not that. I mean, I don't know if I can afford them. I want to write music, and I've already started that. He had a nice manner. He said he didn't know musicians that well, women or men, but he counted on his fingers female writers who'd had children. He actually couldn't think of any. Nope, died of lupus, I countered. Young, 30s, I think. Then, married, but no kids. Happily married? Probably would have preferred Henry James. Well, who wouldn't? I laughed. For years and years, he could make me laugh. Does Yo-Yo Ma have kids? Two, I said. But he also has a wife. Madame Ma, c'est moi. He had an odd brightness I'd heard all my life. You can be both, my mother had said. But my mother was mentally ill. He was not. I believed him, a trumpet promise. Some Bach came into my fingers, cello suite number 2 in D minor, the haunting prelude. I had to sit on my hand. That evening, our first date, we had a conversation about who would do what. With a woman who worked, it'd have to be 50-50, he said. Of course. We didn't talk about that again until after William was born. In Paul's gaze, it seemed I couldn't fail, as if the terrors I'd known, so looming they'd strapped me in bed a few days a month, had been products of an overly active imagination. So this is how it works, I thought. It turned out to be easier than I'd expected. When I talked about my childhood, his face took on an expression of pity, which also looked like reverence. Then he'd twirl in a dance step with a confident air. I marveled at these shuffles and turns as one would at the performance of a child not yours, watching happiness. I became accustomed to myself in this new atmosphere. My opinions grew emphatic, my gestures expansive, my stumbling attempts at jokes more frequent. Who was to say this wasn't love? I burrowed into his chest at night. He lost his hands in my hair, and I could sleep. Children were a star wish. Love had been a problem already. Perhaps I wanted to curtail my range. In the custody of Paul, within the larger corporation of his family, things I'd feared all my life became impossible. No baron lived in poverty or even without a weekly cleaning woman. I loved their formality and cleanness. We would always be in rooms like this. Insanity occurred, but that too with the proper funds rounded to eccentricity. He carried within him a solid floor. Like most women, I'd spent a great deal of time thinking about whom I would marry. Paul never felt like the end of all that yearning. Could anyone have been? I hadn't really known, up close, a good love. I promised myself to be grateful. I'd always perplexed my mother. She attributed my temperament to my face and never ceased trying to fix me up. My wedding made the happiest day of her life. Balloons loose in a blue sky. 42 of Paul's relatives stood in suits as we said our vows. On my side, only my mother. My friends felt exuberant with relief. Paul was beautiful, that word. A perfect profile, dark, smooth skin, Grecian hair, the small wire glasses of a yeshiva boy you wanted to lift off. He had a mother-father Jewish family who belonged to the Harmony Club. The student photographer followed a guest we hardly knew. A dozen pictures of this oboist appeared on the proof sheets and a half page of my mother in her long white skirt and cranberry jacket, looking, as one of the ushers said, like something out of the Kennedy era. But not one shot of the mother of the groom. In the only picture that included both of us.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.